His eyes were so bright, I would have sworn they were kind of a twinkly blue, except I know Japanese don't have blue eyes. And I know, you know, his eyes were dark. I mean, they were like a dark brown. But there was a light coming out of him. In a way, I think he rested in void, but he could manifest any one of those elements. Obviously, we saw him manifest ground over and over again when he sat like this and had people push on him. When he held a staff out and had people push on it, he was able to be so deeply grounded. I watched, and you can see it on the movies, I watched people's feet slide on the tatami when they're pushing against his head or they're pushing against the staff. There was no way that you can fake it. People have come up with all kinds of stupid explanations. But I fail to see how anybody who notices can explain how someone can be pushing so hard that literally their feet are slipping back along the tatami. Just like you're really trying to push a wall over, and you're pushing so hard that your feet slip. And O-Sensei had that ability to be so deeply grounded that, as I said, he could. That's the first thing that totally blew me away and got me to open to the possibility that the Aikido was a mystical art far beyond my rational understanding. When O-Sensei would, almost every morning that he felt like it, would stick a staff out and have one, two, or three people try to push it at right angles. And I knew that a five-year-old kid with that leverage could take a staff out from my hands. So the fact that he would just do that almost every morning is a kind of here's a reminder. I began to open to the possibility that there was far more in the world, and especially in Aikido, than I could imagine. One morning I felt, a lot of energy. My meditation was really still and calm, and I felt, I was Shodan at the time, and a really pretty new Shodan. And I said, I'm ready to grab me a Nidan or a Sandan and really train hard, really work with someone who's going to push me, that I can, practice using this energy and this clarity that I feel this morning. So I come into Hombu going, let me have a Nidan. Maybe I can get me a Sandan, sort of. And at Hombu, you trained with someone for the whole hour. It was not technique by technique, so it was very important who you sat next to. And it was a kind of a musical chairs that would go on, where people would scoot next to their favorite partners. So I'm sitting looking, and Virginia comes in, who I was very, very friendly with. And Virginia, who had come from New York to spend 5 years or more in Tokyo and really master Aikido, and had this other foreigner in tow. And he kind of looked glassy-eyed, and I'd never seen him before. And she said, "Bob, this is Bert. He just got in this morning, 4 a.m., flight from Australia. And he's been doing Aikido for a couple months." And she sat him down next to me and went next to one of my favorite Nidans to train with him. I could have killed her at the moment. And I thought, oh, Jesus, I've got Bert. Bert has been training for a couple of months. Bert is jet-lagged. Bert speaks no Japanese and has no idea what training in Tokyo is like. If I don't train with him, he might die. that some Japanese could really hurt him. Because he's not going to be fast enough. He doesn't have the reflexes. He doesn't know what he's getting into. But I don't want to work with him. I want to work with a Nidan at least. And I thought, okay, I could leave him to the mercy of somebody. That's not good Aikido. I really believe that, that O-Sensei said something about Aikido being love and compassion. Didn't feel right to leave him to the mercy of some Japanese who couldn't speak with him. And might not have calibrated in time. I said, my second choice is, I could exhaust him in about probably somewhere between 5 and 10 minutes, depending on how nice I was. I mean, I was a good Hombu Shodan. I trained every day, 7 days a week. I've been training for over a year. Took me months to get up to the pace that they did at Hombu, and I was in good shape. Didn't feel right to exhaust him either. That felt a little not compassionate. So I said, my only other choice is to work with Bert for an hour. And so I bowed to Bert, and we started training, and I realized that Bert was almost a rank beginner, jet-lagged, not in shape. And I pushed Bert, and I had a real sense of what we call someone's comfort zone, and I pushed him to what I felt was the edge of his comfort zone, but not beyond. I wasn't going to tyrannize him. I wasn't, going to be violent in any way with him, but I wasn't going to take care of him that much, and I did the best training I could pushing him as far as I felt was reasonable. Not to tire him out, but just simply that we could both get the very best training we could, given where he was and given where I was. But I kept looking out of the corner of my eyes at those incredible Nidans and some of the Shodans who took the most gorgeous Ukemi and longing to be training with them. Like, that's the real Aikido. There's fireworks, literally, it looked like fireworks. I mean, people coming in hard and their uke taking fabulous falls, and I'm going, it felt like, you know, doing Tai Chi underwater, sort of. And I'm training like this with Bert, absolutely staying with him, you know, going to the edge of his comfort zone, not beyond it, and watching with envy everybody else, every other black belt in the dojo. And I was probably the least advanced black belt, I'm sure I was, in the dojo at the time. Well, O-Sensei would watch training. He could watch from his house or he could watch from the office without us knowing it. And he often did. And usually when he came in after watching training, he was unhappy. And that was true this morning. He came out with kind of fire in his eyes. We all sat in Seiza. And he looked around. He said, nobody is doing Aikido properly. None of you understand Aikido. Nobody is doing Aikido properly in this whole dojo, except for Bob. And that's probably the only time in my life where I understood the true meaning of I could have been knocked over by a feather. I mean, I was so stunned that I was envying everybody else. I was doing this very slow practice, and I really wanted to do real fast, exciting, dramatic practice. And as I thought about it over time, I thought, how much did O-Sensei see? And my guess is, I have no proof, but my guess is he saw everything. And he saw that I wanted to train with the Nidan and the Sandan. He saw I really didn't want to train with Bert, but I chose to train with Bert. I'm sure that what he saw was that I was absolutely present with Bert, that I was doing the best training I could, working with him, not tyrannizing him, not treating him as an object, and yet not going easy, not babying him either. And I think that's what he wants from us in Aikido. He wants us to train with that kind of attentiveness, that kind of sensitivity, and yet that kind of an edge. I mean, we do either often too much babying on the one hand and don't push people so they have to stay alert, they have to stay sharp, or on the other hand, they're the people that simply brutalize their and think they're doing good martial arts by not being sensitive, not having caring, not having compassion. And the lesson, one of the great lessons in that was fancy technique doesn't matter. We all are in love with fancy technique. It looks good. It feels good. And you know, we think other people think it looks good, so it feels great to our egos. And what O-Sensei told me, I mean, more clearly than writing a book about it, it doesn't matter. Flashy technique that looks great is not Aikido. He hollered at the guys with flashy technique. You know, it's not the Aikido he wanted. What he wanted was someone who was attentive to his partner, who was blending with his partner, who was present with his partner, and who wasn't going easy on his partner. One of the things, and this is not my own memory, but others who have spoken of O-Sensei said, for example, when you grabbed his arm, it would feel like it was too big to hold, and then suddenly it was too small to hold. It was like you were trying to grab a girder, and you couldn't get your arms around it, and then it descended to like a monofilament wire. Neither one could you really get a hold of. And to me, that's a reminder of O-Sensei's ability to shift bodies, which is what I'm talking about when I'm talking about the five elements, is you literally have a wind body or a water body or a fire body. And O-Sensei did not stay in the same mode. You know, he didn't kind of stay in the same body. There was some way that he was able to move in and out of those things. That wasn't my experience of him. My own experience of taking falls for him was simply, I didn't know what he did. I just felt that I missed. I somehow inexplicably swerved out of the way and somehow fell down. And I would get up and say, you know, it must have looked like I was tanking. It must really look bad, and I don't like that. It's like, that's not good for Aikido. That, you know, I want to give an honest attack, and I would go, let me line up. And I would swerve off to the side again. And I would get up with a kind of a dumbfounded expression, and I noticed everybody, except the ukes that had a lot of experience with O-Sensei, they were used to it. But everybody else would get up with a similar dumbfounded expression on their face, like, what happened? Why did I go down? I don't know what happened. So he took pity on me, and without saying anything, we sat knee to knee, just like we were going to do Kokudosa. And he said, stretch out your hand. So I'm thinking, is this going to be Kokudosa? Maybe. It looks, you know, here are my hands out. I like to be in Kokudosa. And he took and he put my wrist together. And he put his hand over both of my wrists. And I still remember his hand was really soft and light, really a feather-light touch. And then he said, push. And I pushed. And the amazing thing was that feather-light touch didn't change. There was still a feather touch on my hand, and I wasn't going anywhere. I wasn't moving. And I've tried it many times since. Whenever you push against someone or something, you can feel that pressure increase when your push increases. There was no counter pressure. There was a feather I couldn't move. So it was almost as though I was in a deep hypnotic trance. I don't think he put me in a trance. I don't think that's how he worked. And of course, what came to me when he said that was, okay, that's why I can't understand what he's doing when I'm attacking full speed. I can't even understand what he's doing when we're both sitting there not moving. But somehow he has the ability to affect my ki flow, to affect my body in a way that is not physical, because if it was physical, I would have felt physical pressure. And I've, in a way, thought about it ever since. And one way I've tried to explain it in language is that O-Sensei had the ability to, in a way, interact with me, or interact with my nervous system, if you will, if you want to use those words, in a way that it didn't feel like he was forcing me to do something. It felt like the movement came out of my own nervous system. In other words, that ability of Aiki, that way of blending with my energy, it did not feel like an alien energetic force or an alien physical force. It's blended so perfectly that it felt like I threw myself, because I didn't feel anything coming in from the outside. Just like it didn't feel like there was anything from the outside stopping me from moving. I don't know why I didn't move, but I couldn't move. And one of the ways that I've tried to language this with students is to say, perhaps the goal of an Aikido technique is not merely to throw your partner, and especially not to have power over your partner so that they know you've overpowered them with strength or technique or speed, but can the goal be to bewilder your partner? Can the goal be to throw your partner in a way that they really don't feel that you did it to them, but that somehow they chose to go down? In other words, can we move in such a way that we're holding the whole interaction, not as me versus you, not as even you and me together, but I'm kind of a little ahead of the game, but can I move in such a way that I come so much in tune with you that the movement is, you don't know why you fell. It wasn't my forcing you to fall. And I think that was the initiation. That's what he really showed me, was that's the goal of Aikido. It's not to be stronger. It's not to force anyone else. But it's to blend so deeply with another person. And of course, you know, as Ellis has said in some of his writings about O-Sensei, O-Sensei didn't hide things. They were out there. He just didn't rub your nose in it. You had to notice what was going on. So it's right there in the name. Aiki is blending your energy, your consciousness, your flow with somebody else's. And if you do it deeply enough, I believe it starts to approach O-Sensei's art. Not that any of us, I've never seen anybody that really approached O-Sensei's art other than at miles away. Higizuchi-sensei, after having been 10th Dan for years, said, and this was back in the mid-70s, he said, maybe in another 40 years. Maybe, you know, were I blessed, I could begin to approach O-Sensei's art. And he was incredibly good. Another favorite story of O-Sensei involves a trip I took to Iwama with him It was actually just he and I and Nakazono Sensei's son, who was probably 13 or something at the time. And he said he wanted to go to Iwama, and everybody else was busy, and I said, I'm not busy. You know, I was doing research at the university, and my time was pretty flexible. And the people in the office went, foreigner? Well, he speaks good Japanese. We've known him for a couple of years. Okay. And O-Sensei was certainly fine with it. So I got to go with O-Sensei. He and I, and as I said, Nakazono's son, just in case they had to have a Japanese kid there. And so we went to Iwama, and we stayed there, I don't know, 4 days or something. And I would get up every morning with him at dawn, and we would go around to the shrines. There's a shrine in the dojo. There was a shrine by the house. There was a shrine in the middle of the fields. And then we went to the main Aikido shrine. And in each place, he would chant, and he would pray, and I would just sit in back of him. But we made this wonderful round of the shrines that were kind of part of his life. His house shrine, the dojo shrine, the shrines outside, and then the great Aikido shrine. You know, and every one of those shrines he pretty much built with his own hands. We trained, we talked, we watched television together. And that's another great O-Sensei story. We watched two programs. One was a Japanese samurai program. It was on every week. And the other one was a Western. The Japanese samurai program was a typical, you know, slash-em-up samurai program where the hero was working his way through lots of bad guys who were simply there for him to demonstrate his art. And he kind of liked it. He didn't say much about it. And then we saw a Western movie in which there was the hero and his girlfriend and the kind of dark hero who was on the bad guy's side but ended up protecting the hero. And taking the bullet meant for the hero at the end. And O-Sensei was so angry at the end that this guy got killed. And he started saying, that's the problem with the West. It's so bloody. It's so violent. How could they have done that? And I'm sitting there thinking, Sensei, do you know how many samurai got killed an hour ago? You know, many more of them, but the difference was they weren't real. You know, they were like training dummies, sort of. And this guy, you know, this dark hero was real. He got to know him. You got to care about him. He was a real person. And O-Sensei just went on and on about, that was the trouble with the West. It was too violent. It was too brutal. I said nothing. Deguchi was probably the greatest spiritual teacher in Japan. There were great Zen Roshis too, I'm sure, but no question that Deguchi was an incredible spiritual teacher. Unbelievable power, healing powers. He had telepathic powers. He could tell what was going on in people. He could tell what was going on at distances. Not that that's important, but I think he really did transform O-Sensei. And O-Sensei's Aikido was founded in the context of a spiritual community. His first students were all disciples of this great mystical teacher. That's built into the fabric of Aikido. Now, the fact that later when he went to Tokyo, he didn't talk about it, but nevertheless, in his Aikido, in his own development, that's really there. O-Sensei was a mystic. He saw the world as a mystic. He developed Aikido as a mystic. He was ordered to develop Aikido by his spiritual teacher. O-Sensei's response to the war was, I'm going to Iwama to do something positive, which is to grow food. So, in a way, he pulled back without making a public statement. Now, the reason, this is my interpretation, the reason that he did that was because of the Omoto-kyo incidents. His teacher, Deguchi Onisaburo, and again, this is somewhat in the literature, was a crazy wisdom teacher. He was a crazed artist, mystic, spiritual teacher who did all kinds of nutty things by, you know, the average person's point of view. He was a crazy artist. And he did and said things that people didn't understand. He also did and said things that people did understand and disagreed with, like war is not a good thing. At the time when Japanese was in its best and highest military phase. All men and women are brothers and sisters at a time when Japan was totally racist. So he really stood for universal peace and universal brotherhood, sisterhood, when it was not okay, when it was unpatriotic to say those things. He was way ahead of his time, a little ahead of our time, perhaps. And because of that combination of things, they were very suspicious of him. I think he had 2 million followers at one point when Japan wasn't that big. He had a magazine that was a very popular magazine throughout Japan. So they suspected him of undermining the government. They had weird rumors that he had a secret army training, that he had guns and explosives hidden in, because they had a commune. I mean, it was like Rajneesh, sort of. They had their own commune, which is where O-Sensei began Aikido in Ayabe. And so they went in there and they investigated and they found nothing. They found no arms, they found no explosives. So they blew everything up. They dynamited the temple. They found one or two little things. I mean, if you're going to spend a lot of time and energy, you're going to find something. And one of the main reasons that they threw him in jail was he rode a white horse. And nobody in Japan but the emperor was allowed to ride a white horse. Now, he was a crazy mystic who, you know, was also in other states of consciousness a lot. And so he rode a white horse and he dressed up as Maitreya Buddha. He dressed up as, in almost every religious mystical tradition, he had a costume. He was an incredible artist. I mean, he wrote poetry that's as good as Rumi. He wrote prose. He wrote 80 volumes, Tales of the Unseen World, which he dictated from experiences he had of other places and other, you know, other worlds. He was a potter whose pottery are museum quality pieces. He wrote his own movie script when movies were brand new, and somehow talkies were kind of barely in. And he wrote a movie script, and he produced and directed and wrote the script and starred in the movie with more costumes, of course. So, and he stood for these unbelievably modern principles. So Japanese are really embarrassed about him because he's embarrassing. And he was considered a traitor to Japan because his values were so antithetical to my country before everything else, my people, my race. And in Shinto, for example, he said that Amaterasu no Mikami, the sun goddess, who's the kami of the Japanese people, is basically I think it's Shinjin no Mikami, who's the kami of the whole human race, who's obviously the larger principle that the whole human race needs, you know, has its own divinity connected with it. The rest of the Shinto community was not happy. Because Shinto is the race of the religion of the Japanese people. It's the god, you know, Amaterasu no Omikami is the goddess of the Japanese people, the kami of the Japanese people. So, I mean, theologically he made trouble, politically he made trouble. So people, most Japanese either don't know about him and don't want to know about him. He was thrown in jail on almost trumped up charges, and O-Sensei barely escaped from being thrown in jail also. He escaped mainly because he was teaching Aikido to the head of the Osaka police, the chief of police in Osaka, and he was living in Osaka when they raided. I think Osaka was probably the closest main city to Ayabe, and the chief of police just refused to arrest him and send someone to get him out of town. Deguchi basically said to him, pretty much, I know what's going to happen to me. I'm cutting you loose. You have a great future as a martial artist. You go to Tokyo and I want you to pursue your future. You should be the great artist, the great martial artist in Japan in this century. And so, yeah, it was pretty clear from the things I've read. Now, everybody in Omotokyo, a lot of people had mixed feelings about that because they thought he should have stayed and been thrown in jail too. But that's why O-Sensei didn't teach much about spirituality, because he didn't dare. I mean, he actually, in order to stay in the good graces of the establishment, he taught at all the different military academies, the spy school, the this school, the that, you know, and made connections with admirals and generals and high-ranking Japanese. They were suspicious of him because of his connection with Deguchi, but they saw he was a great martial artist, and he realized he had to do those things. He had to teach in those military schools. He had to make those connections. When the war came, he quit. You know, he basically, I'm not teaching at those schools anymore, and I'm going to Iwama, where I have a little hut, sort of. I have some land, and I'm going to farm. And he said many times, farming and Aikido. Aikido to train yourself, and farming to create food for others to serve. There's another time. This was in 1964, the Olympics was on, it was the summer of 64, And I was training, and I stayed a little later after the 8 o'clock class. There's an 8 to 9 class. And I didn't have anything to go to right after, so I stayed, and I was training, and was on the mat. And all of a sudden, Kishomaro Sensei, his son, came out and said, "Would you stay and translate for us, please?" And I said, "Sure." And in comes this Italian national radio crew. They were in Japan, as most countries were sending, you know, sending radio television crews, because the Olympics was the big news. So here are these guys coming in with their, you know, their TV cameras, and their Hong Kong representative. I don't know if they had anybody in Tokyo. I don't think they did. So their Hong Kong representative, who was Italian, who spoke English but no Japanese. And then the guys fresh from Italy who spoke no English, much less Japanese. And so there was this wonderful comedy of errors almost. So he would talk to me, they would say something to him, and he would talk to me in English. I would talk to Kishomaru Sensei in Japanese, and Kishomaru would talk in nicer Japanese to O-Sensei, which was fine with me, because O-Sensei saw everything and understood everything, but somehow it went through this chain. And so they set up, and they start shooting, and O-Sensei starts saying, "Your center in Aikido is the center of the universe, and you have Izanagi no Mikami on your left side," and, you know, and going on and on with Shinto mythology. And, you know, at one point, one of the Italians kind of snaps in Italian something that I knew was, "Would you tell him to do something? This is really boring footage." And so the chief, their Far Eastern chief, said, "You know, would you ask him to do something? We're running out of film." And I say, more politely, "Would you please ask O-Sensei if perhaps he could demonstrate more physical?" And then he said, in much more polite Japanese, "O-Sensei, that, you know, they don't have much film, and could you, you know, demonstrate more of the waza of Aikido?" And O-Sensei saw the whole thing. I mean, he knew what the guys were saying in Italian, I'm sure. So he said, "Okay," you know. And he lined up, it was like the uchideshi at Honbu. He lined up about, there were four or five of them, he lined them up, and we've actually seen this version on television, on some of the DVDs as well, and he walked down the line. One, two, three, four, five throws. And he looked up at them as if to say, "Well, that was about one throw per second, you know, or per half second. Was that enough, you know, was that enough kind of content for you?" And there was this gleam in his eye. It was just wonderful. You again, you watch the DVDs, there's one part where he throws several ukes and he stacks them. He stacks, you know, which is, you don't do that in Japan normally. That's, you know, he stacks them, he puts his foot on the top one, you know, kind of like the big game hunter. So, I mean, he really did have a tremendous sensitivity to everything going on around him, and a wonderful sense of humor about it. I mean, he also had a lot of passion, and when things weren't going right, he wasn't afraid to express it. But he did have a fabulous sense of humor. I had another wonderful encounter with O-Sensei. He would go once every few weeks to the Omoto-kyo shrine, headquarters in Tokyo. And Omoto-kyo was co-founded by his master, Deguchi Onisaburo. So it's the Shinto sect that he became part of and practiced for his whole life after meeting his teacher. And so he went in beautiful kimono, a beautiful black kimono with the family mon on it, and I went in a suit and tie. I'm sitting with him in the back of a cab, and I suddenly go, "I'm sitting with O-Sensei in a cab. I'm next to him, and, you know, I have a chance to ask him a question. There's nothing else going on." And then I thought, you know, it better be a good question, because O-Sensei was not real patient with nonsense or stupidity, so I already, there was a lot of pressure. But I knew I had to ask him something, like this was like what you would have to go to the Himalayas to meet a sage, and here I was in a cab in Tokyo with that same opportunity. And I said, "O-Sensei, what is the right attitude towards your aite, towards your partner?" And then he smiled, and I thought inside, oh, thank God. He liked it. He liked the question. And what he said was, "Your attitude towards your partner should be that of a parent toward a child. You, an attitude of love and an attitude of that you're expecting that they're going to follow your guidance, that you're going to lovingly guide them, but you expect that they're going to follow you." You're going to lead them. And I thought that was, what a beautiful answer that is, that whenever one is doing Aikido, as Nage, we're acting the way a good parent does with a child. Not to beat or harass or force, but to guide. To put out your guidance, to put out leadership, if you will, in a very clear way. Now I know, as having been a parent for 4 children and 40 years or something like that, if I ever asked my kids when they were younger, would you like to go to bed? The answer always would be no. You know, that's not leadership. I mean, and so often as parents, that's the mistake we make, is would you like to? And they're always going to say, well, forget that. Or you must, or I'm going to beat you in the head, which is the other extreme. Neither one is good parenting. You know, what makes a lot more sense is we have an agreement. You have 5 more minutes. You have 5 minutes to get ready to go to bed. You at least have a fighting chance. So again, I've meditated on that response because it's deceptively simple sounding, that your attitude toward your partner in Aikido should be that of a parent to a child. Obviously loving, but really expecting they're going to follow your guidance. Not expecting conflict, not going, oh, there's conflict, so I'm going to try to break his arm. Well, that's not exactly a parental attitude, and obviously the expectation of conflict will set up conflict. So the loving expectation that they'll follow you if you're clear makes a great deal of sense in Aikido. I was with my good friend Tomita, who was I had a number of close friends who were my training partners at Hombu Dojo, and Tomita was one of them. He graduated a couple of years before from Yokohama University, I think engineering department, and had been head of the Aikido club there. And he invited me to go up to Iwama where they were going to have a gashku. And the current students had asked him to come because he was either between jobs or working part-time. He had enough flexible time that he could go. And they invited him to come as the old president of the club to lead the gashku. And he invited me to come with him because I also had fairly flexible time and we were very close. So he and I were from Hombu and everybody else was from the Yokohama school. And we started training there. And it was wonderful training. It was very vigorous. And we did some running in the morning. And we did some gardening in O-Sensei's little garden / farm in the afternoons. And the correct Japanese etiquette was that Tomita was to ask O-Sensei before every class, may I teach as your representative, Sensei? And O-Sensei was in residence. He was there. Now, there are 2 reasons for that. One is, if the founder of Aikido is around, you don't teach Aikido without his permission. It's his art, obviously, so that as his representative, can you teach? Can he give you permission to teach? So he was the founder of the dojo. So it's a second reason why you really need to ask his permission to teach. So Tomita did. Even though we knew perfectly well, O-Sensei had no desire to teach a bunch of college kids Aikido. That was, that was not real high on his list of stuff he wanted to do. So he didn't. I mean, he always said, Tomita, go ahead. And about the second day in the afternoon, we had trained all morning, we had had lunch, we'd done some gardening. Came time for the afternoon class, maybe 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And he goes in and O-Sensei's sleeping. And he thinks to himself, do I wake O-Sensei up to bother him, or do I simply teach the class because they asked me to come and teach the class, and he said yes every single class. And he made the wrong choice. He chose not to wake O-Sensei up. To make matters more interesting, someone had been killed the week before, and I think it was in Osaka, high fall, and he landed badly and he broke his neck. O-Sensei was incredibly upset. I mean, he took responsibility for that death, even though he was in Tokyo, even though he may not have even had much direct training of the guy who was teaching that particular class. Nevertheless, I was awed by the way in which O-Sensei took responsibility for everything that happened on every Aikido mat, everywhere. And I kind of wanted to tell him, O-Sensei, don't do that. That's too much strain, but I knew that was so much out of line, I didn't go there. But it was awesome in a way that that's how he felt, that it was his responsibility for everybody in Aikido. And he really said that at various times and felt that. And he talked about how because people didn't understand Aikido, this could happen. If people really understood Aikido, that wouldn't have happened. Well, he was sleeping and we started training. It took about 2 Harukemis. And I think it was like, you know, an old racehorse hearing the bugle. O-Sensei was up and he came into the dojo, and I'm not sure that fire and sparks really came out of his eyes, but it felt like it. He was angry. I mean, he had fire going, passion, fire. And I was sitting next to Tomita in Seiza, very quietly, and that energy that was directed toward my poor friend Tomita was too close to me. I mean, I really had this sense of wanting to flip a tatami mat up and go under. You know, it was like the hurricane really didn't care personally, and it felt a little bit like, geez, that energy is just incredibly uncomfortable, and I couldn't imagine how Tomita felt. And he went on and on, saying, lack of etiquette, lack of respect, this is related to why this man died. None of you understand Aikido, this is terrible, on and on and on and on. How could you do that to teach a class without my permission? On and on. And I'm sitting there, very uncomfortable, wanting to kind of open a tatami mat and get out of that kind of flow of energy. And when he stops, he looks, and he's going to choose, he says he's going to choose an uke. Well, who's he going to choose? He only knew 2 of us from Hombu. So he reaches and comes like that to me. And I swear, if it wasn't for a hakama, my knees would have been so obviously shaking. I once, when I was younger, had gotten into a bull ring with a live bull. It's not too smart. But there was that sense of, you know, if you screw up, you're really dead. You know, it's not there's no room for error. Another bull had its horns capped, but it was a lot of bull moving real fast. And I had that same feeling I had in the bull ring, which is, oh shit, I could die. You know, the impact could just kill me. And so I came out and attacked O-Sensei, and he threw me lighter than he probably ever had before. And he threw me lightly again. He looked at me, and I swear I heard the words almost, you know I'm a master. And being a master means being a master over myself. It's really okay. I know, you know, I've got control of the fire. And it's not going to leak out. You know, you're safe. But it, you know, it's a wonderful story because, you know, I think that notion of, yeah, I mean, he put fire out when he wanted to. He owned it. It didn't own him. And that was the art. He owned the art. I mean, he took responsibility for the art and cared about, and he really felt that it was the fundamental intention that we hold when we go onto the mat that's important. It's the context in which we're doing Aikido is all important. And if the context is being strong and being martial and beating up other people, that's going to create injuries. That's going to create something that's not Aikido, not his Aikido. It's an Aikido Jiu-Jitsu or many other things, but it's not O-Sensei's Aikido.